morning. This is Danielle Bailey, and you're listening to Heaven Bound.
I see a sea. I see my home. I see my blessed King there on his throne.
Good morning again, friends, and welcome one more time to Heaven Bound. Once again, on behalf of the good folks here at Calvary Bible Church, I am Doug Benedict, and Pastor Jim Jenkins will be joining us just a little bit later on after this word about the church and a couple songs that we have picked out for you this morning. So to start things off, let's listen to the Nottingham Four as they sing, God Will Send His Angel.
Oh, Elijah was a prophet of God, but sometimes he got down. He ran for the mountains, couldn't keep his feet from moving on the ground. Old Jezebel said she'd take his life, so running off, he didn't go. But God sent his angel, his love for him to show. God sent his angel to bring all you need. God sent his angel to make you feel happy and free. When trials come and you get down and don't know what to do, turn it over to Jesus and he'll carry you through.
Let me tell you, friend, I don't know about you, but sometimes I get down.
I get so discouraged, can't get my feet to move on the ground. When old Satan comes and makes me blue, there's only one thing to do. I turn it over to Jesus and he carries me through.
God sent his angel to bring all you need.
God sent his angel to make you feel happy and free. When trials come and you get down and don't know what to do, turn it over to Jesus and he'll carry you through. Turn it over to Jesus, turn it over to Jesus.
Turn it over to Jesus, and he will carry you through. What a great way to get rid of whatever it is that's bothering you. And if you don't have that personal relationship with God to where you feel like you can hand over your burdens that are getting you down, we are so excited that you found the program today. And we hope you get a blessing out of the good Southern gospel music as well as the preaching by Pastor Jim Jenkins. And we do hope that if you are not born again, on your way to heaven, that today will be the day that that change will be made. And if you have any questions or you would like to know a little bit more about the church, give us a call today. Our phone number is 315-348-6271, or you can send an email, and that email address is cbclewiscounty@gmail.com. So if you need a ride to church today, and we hope you will come today, you can send a request to that email or give a call, and we'll try to line someone up. Or if you have your own means of transportation, put in your GPS 6968 Sweeney Road in Gregg, New York, or follow these super easy directions if you're coming out of the south like Utica or Boonville, head north on Route 12. If you're coming out of the north like Watertown or Lowville, head south on Route 12. If you're coming out of Rome or West Leiden, head north on 26. Keep straight on 12D, and then head north on Route 12. Then you're going to make a right-hand turn onto Burdick's Crossing Road. Now all the directions come together right here. Take Burdick's Crossing Road all the way to the end. Make a left-hand turn onto Gregg Road, head up the hill, and make your first right-hand turn onto Sweeney Road. And now this is one way that you can check us out, or if you're laid up and just cannot make it, this is available for you, but don't use this as an excuse not to come. We do stream all of our services live at cbclewiscounty.com, as well as livestream.com. Our times today, with being the last Sunday of the month, we'll begin this morning at 9:30 with Sunday school, followed immediately at 10:30 with the morning service. We'll break starting at noon, and we'll be back tonight at 6 o'clock for our evening service. Then we'll be back once again Wednesday night at 7 o'clock for our midweek prayer service. A few announcements coming up. May 1st through the 4th, that's a Sunday through Wednesday, we will have Randy Chauvin here with us. And all those meetings will start at 7 o'clock, except for on Sunday, and he'll be here all day with us. And also June 19th, we'll begin at 10 o'clock in the morning, and that is our 37th anniversary here at Calvary Bible Church. Put those in your calendar and plan on joining us on those days. Let's get moving on as Pastor's getting ready to go. And he's going to talk about a real sore subject with me. I'm always failing, no matter what I do. Always failing. And if you feel this way, this is going to be great for you. Because there is a way that we can still prevail and end out good in the end, even though we have failed God's test. So as you turn into Romans chapter 3, beginning in verse 23, let's listen to the Gaither Vocal Band as they sing, "I'll Meet You in the Morning."
I will meet you in the morning by the bright riverside, when all sorrows have drifted away. I'll be standing at the portals when the gates open wide, at the close of life's long dreary day.
The Gaithers, "I Will Meet You in the Morning by the Bright Riverside When All Sorrow Has Drifted Away. I'll be standing at the portal when the gate opened wide, at the close of life's long dreary day." Wow, that's a great song. Hey, will I meet you in the morning? The eternal day? I hope so, friend. Man, I sure hope so. I ain't think that you listened to this program and you wound up not making heaven. Man, what a tragedy that would be. Romans chapter 3 and verse 23 is an inclusive verse. Includes everybody. Now, not everybody wants to be included, but it includes everybody. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." All have sinned. and come show the glory of God. We live in strange times. So what do you mean by that? Well, we live in a time when you say, well, we don't want people to think badly about them. I mean, educate. We don't want people to think badly about themselves. We don't want anybody. Some educator told my wife, well, if you give them that grade, you're setting them up for failure. Well, they deserve to fail, but that's neither here nor there. We don't want anybody to fail. We don't want anybody to fail. And so we don't want anybody to feel bad about themselves. Well, you can't talk to them that way. They'll feel bad about themselves. We don't want anybody to feel bad about themselves. It's the philosophy of everybody gets to play on the team. Doesn't matter whether they're pathetic or not. Everybody gets a chance to play. I call it the ASO philosophy. Maybe I shouldn't say that, but everybody gets to play. We don't keep score. We're just going to let them go out there and roll around. They've changed the honor roll to the effort roll. Well, they put forth a good effort, so we don't want to make them feel bad about themselves, so we just call it the effort roll. I read where one school had 23 valedictorians because they didn't want to make, you know, the other guys feel badly, so they had 23 of them. Christian life, Bible says in 1 Corinthians 9:27, know ye not that they which run a race run all. There's a reason they run the race. They're trying to get a winner. There's a reason why they play the game. There's a reason why they keep score. I remember I used to coach ASO. This one lady came up to me one time. She said, I don't approve the way you coach, but I want you to know you're a really good coach. I love coaching. I coached, you know, a long time. Coached Little League for Glenfield a long time. We had good teams. Unfortunately, and as I told the kids, the boys, this a lot of times, and we had a girl or two every once in a while, but I said, you know, all men are created equal, and that's pretty much where it starts and stops. Because an unfortunate fact of life is there's just some people better at some things than others. But we don't want anybody to feel bad about it. When I was in high school, they used to give out letters. Now, if I remember correctly, and I probably don't, but I'm trying to remember, I believe we played 10 games a year, and there were 40 quarters in a year, and I think you had to play like 25 quarters to get a letter. I remember when I got one in the 10th grade playing varsity soccer. Man, I was really, I still have it. It sits on my desk in my office. I was so proud of that thing. Man, I went out and got, you know, the old varsity sweater, and I put that high school letter on, and I wore it around. Man, I was just so proud of that because not everybody got them. I can remember when I played varsity soccer for 4 years. I got on in 9th grade. And I remember seeing those upperclassmen wear that, and I said, man, that's what I wanted. Because not everybody got one. Now it's like, we don't have any champions. We give everybody a trophy for participation. Here's your participation trophy. Here's your participation ribbon. You know, we don't want to make anybody feel badly. You don't want to make anybody feel bad. It might give them a poor self-concept. It might have an inferiority complex. I'm telling you, there are a lot of bad things that happened to me along the road of life. I remember when I was in kindergarten or first grade, one of the two, we were playing Farmer and the Dell. You know, the farmer takes a wife, the wife takes a child takes a dog takes a cat takes what's the cat take? I don't know, but anyway, wound up. Somebody took the rat. I was the rat. I was the last guy in the circle. Do you know how bad I felt? I felt so bad I went home and got my father's machine gun and came and shot every... No, listen. It's a fact of life that some people are better at some things than others. But we don't want to make anybody feel bad today. We know we don't want to make anybody feel bad. culturally, well, we're not so bad. You know, we're not really that bad. And so we killed 20 people. We're not really that bad. Stole a bunch. We're not really that bad. Some people's idea is just to, you know, just make it. I remember when I was in college, one of the most satisfying grades I ever got in college was a B. A B, yeah, because you have to understand that teacher was unbelievably hard. And not only that, but in the history of civ class, he failed half the class. So when I had him for a specific class on Constitution, and I got a B out of that class, man, that was satisfying. But I want to tell you something. He didn't give it to me. I had to work for it. We live in a strange time where everybody wants everybody else to feel good about themselves. Well, I got to tell you this, that everybody has failed God's test. Oh, you can't tell everybody that. Everybody has failed the test of God. That's why it says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Did you catch that little three-letter word, all, for all have sinned? What's all mean? All means all. It means everybody. Well, you know, we don't want to make anybody feel bad. We don't want to tell them that. Might give them an inferiority complex. Might give them a poor self-image. If you tell somebody that they failed the test of God. When I was in school, I think I failed a couple tests. First test I ever took when I went back to college was in Ken Chapman's class. Ken Chapman was a dear old saint of God, and man, I got an F. I determined I wasn't going to get another F in that class. I think I wound up with like a 94 average in that class, and he still gave me a B. But I remember failing that test. I shouldn't have failed it, but I did. I failed a test. We have all failed the test of God. Yeah. As I said, yeah, but wait a minute. You don't understand. My F was a little better than your F. I think in college, I think the grading scale was... Man, some guy's grading scale was anything below a 70 was an F. I believe it was, may have been 65, but 60, no, that was an F for sure. Well, I thought it was 60 to 70, 70, no, no, no. Well, my F wasn't as bad as your F. Yeah, but I got news for you, pal. You still failed. Yeah, but my F was almost a D minus. Doesn't matter. You still failed. Yeah, but your F was only, you only got like a 10. My wife was telling me about somewhere somebody took a test. And the person, I don't think I did too bad on this. They got 12 out of 85. 12 out of 85. Man, in school they used to give you credit for at least spelling your name right. 12 out of 85. Well, my F's not quite as bad as your F, but it's still an F. Because, well, I'm not as bad as that person over there. And I don't mean this. Please take this in the spirit in which it is said. I'm not as bad as Adolf Hitler. He killed 6 million Jewish people. And Joseph Stalin killed about 15 million Russians, and in the Cultural Revolution of Red China, about 32 million were killed. And Pol Pot had about 2 million of the 6 million Cambodians killed. Well, I'm not as bad as that Pol Pot guy. I'm not as bad as Mao, and I'm not as bad as Stalin or Hitler. They were all horrible people, and they were. And as badly as they failed, so did you. You got an F too. You're in the same group as they are. Yeah, but I'm not as bad as they are. That's not the point. Point is that you failed. You failed God's test. You miss the mark. You are a failure, spiritually speaking, in the sight of God. Yeah, but I'm not as bad as that. You're missing the point. The point is that we all took a test from God and that everybody failed. You did. I did. Doug did. My wife did. My kids did. Everybody in my church did. Everybody in Lewis County did. Everybody in New York State did. Everybody in America, everybody in the world has taken the test of God and failed it. There's surely somebody. No, everybody failed. Everybody failed. But how about a makeup? There are no makeups in this game, in this test. I want a do-over. You don't get a do-over in the test of life. But surely you can't tell me that I'm as bad as those other bad people. I'm telling you, you failed God's test. For there is none righteous, no, not one. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Everybody has sinned. Everybody has sinned, and everybody has come short of the mark that God has established. Well, is there nothing that I can do? Nope, not a thing. There isn't anything that you can do. I remember sometimes, you know, once in a while, the whole class would do badly on a test, and in my opinion, then the teacher did a poor job of teaching. But the whole class would fail. Teacher come in and say, I'm disgusted with you guys, but I'm going to give you a chance. I'll give you a makeup test. We'll average the two grades together, and we'll see what we come up with. Now, the makeup test was the same as the first test, so there was no reason why you shouldn't have at least gotten a C out of the test. But I don't want to use the word game, in the process of life, there are no do-overs. There are no, can I take that test again? My friend, you have failed and failed miserably. And there's nothing you can do about it. Not a thing. Now, Jesus can. He is able. He is the one that can make the test right. See, what do you mean, preacher? Well, the only person, can I put it like this? The only person to pass the test got an A+, and that was Jesus. The Bible says he didn't come to destroy the law, but he came to fulfill it. Christ came, fulfilled the law, and passed the test, and that made him the suitable sacrifice for all those who took the test and failed. Jesus took the test and passed it for you. Now, will you accept what he did? Will you accept what Jesus did for you? He passed the test with flying colors, and he paid the sin debt that you owe because you failed. And now he gives you opportunity. He gives me the opportunity, you the opportunity. Jesus said, here, I took the test for you. You can have my grade. You can have my grade. You know, in school, people are always trying to get answers from other people's tests or homework or whatever. In this case, Jesus said, I took the test and you can have it. It's yours. I'll freely give it to you. Freely give it to you. The gift of God. The gift of God is eternal life. How do we get it? If Jesus offers it freely, all you have to do is receive it. John 1:12, but as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So now the great question is this. Since we have all failed, there are no do-overs, no takeovers, and we have failed in the game of life, what are we going to do? Well, there's nothing to do. The question really is this. Will you accept what Jesus did for you. Friend, you failed God's test. You are a miserable sinner and a failure. But Jesus took the test and passed it with flying colors and now offers it freely to you. And now you have to determine, will I accept it or not? Will I accept what Jesus did or not? He offers it to us. All we have to do is take it. John 1:12 again. But as many as received him, as many as took him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. This morning, you're listening. Listen, you failed the test. There's nothing you can do about it. Surely there's something I must know. There's nothing. You're a failure. You're done. You're finished. But Jesus took the test and passed it and said, I'll give you my A. All you got to do is take the test out of my hand. Jesus paid your sin debt, paid the price that you owed that you could not pay. He suffered and bled and died on the cross to pay for your sins. And now he invites you to come to the water freely and drink. Come to the fountain and drink freely of the water of life. You only have two options on this. Either accept it or reject it. Well, I don't know. Let me think about it. No. Either accept it or reject it. Acts chapter 17. Paul preached at Athens, and it says that some mocked, made fun of him. Others said, we will hear thee again on this matter. And the third group said, but certain men clave unto Paul and believed. Would you believe? Would you believe enough to put your trust on Jesus? Would you believe enough for that? Would you call upon him today? Would you ask him, Lord, I realize I've failed. I realize I've come short. Lord Jesus, I realize that you passed the test. You died for me on the cross and paid for my sins. And the best way I know how, Lord Jesus, best way I know how, I trust you as my Savior. Lord Jesus, I trust you. I believe that what you did on the cross paid for my sins. I trust you. Come into my heart and save me right now. See, that's just simply accepting what Jesus did for you, friend. That's trusting what Jesus did for you. Every religion in the world is summed up into two words, do and done. Most religions in the world do this, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. But with Christianity, it's done. It's paid for. All you have to do is receive it. Friend, would you trust him today? Would you call upon him today? Would you ask him to be your Savior? We all took the test and failed. You're going to stand before the great teacher one day. You may as well accept what Jesus did. Trust him today, friend. Call upon him today, because listen to me, tomorrow just might be too late.
What about you, friend? What is keeping you from accepting this free gift and this free home in heaven? Are you tired of failing at everything you do? And I don't mean that in a demeaning manner. Just the world is setting us up so nobody fails. But the reality is they're just masking the fact that everyone is a failure. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Why don't you accept that free gift today? Make today the last day that you are failing at what really matters. And that's where you're going to go when you die. If you have any questions about how you can know for sure that you're going to heaven when you die, or any other questions that we could possibly answer for you, give us a call. Our phone number is 315-348-6271, or send an email. Our email address is cbclewiscounty@gmail.com. Or even better yet, why don't you come join us today? There's an empty place in a pew that can only be filled by you. Thank you again for joining us this half hour. Lord willing, we will catch you again next week on Heaven Bound.